morning, everyone. Welcome to North Hills Christian Church. Welcome to those of you joining us on the live stream this morning.
Once and all, everybody who's here, all of our regulars, anyone who's visiting, anyone joining us on our live stream, or who will be joining us on our video at some point later today or during the week, because not everybody gets up this early. Imagine that. Anyway, we're glad to have you with us this morning. Hopefully you got a program as you came in. I'm going to go off camera. That looks like this. See, now notice something. See how easily that works, okay? So this is the Connect card, which detaches. That is for you to interact with us, to engage with us. Let us know you are here. Sign up for things, prayer requests. Update any of your email or address or phone numbers that we may have that are old. Anything like that, that's what that's for, okay? What's been happening, people come in, you get your program, you leave your program, and you pull the Connect card out of the pew, which is fine. Those are extras. You can use those, too, if you didn't get a program. But if you did, please make it worth that we buy this this card stock. Anyway, we're glad you're here this morning. Just so that everybody is on the same page as far as our Christmas week and what's coming up in the next week plus as far as holiday stuff, okay? Christmas Eve service, this coming Friday. I can't believe it's 5 days away from Christmas Eve. 5 o'clock this Friday. Christmas Eve service, and that is functioning as our primary weekend service. This is a full service, worship and carols and communion and a message and some special things that we've been working on that you'll find out when you come, okay? So that is Christmas Eve this Friday at 5 o'clock. The Sunday after that, there are no physical services, but look in your email. You'll get a simple devotional that'll be sent out and available to you. The following Sunday after that, we're doing what we call a family communion brunch for those that are in town. It's basically just kind of a version of what we see the Acts church doing in the early on in the book of Acts, where it says that they would get together, they would eat together in homes with glad and sincere hearts. And we're going to do that in this home, so to speak. Downstairs, we're going to have a short communion devotional, and we're all just going to eat some good food. So bring some sort of brunch, breakfast kind of thing to share, and we're all going to do that. That is the second at 10 o'clock, our normal service time. All right, so that is what the next week plus looks like as far as Christmas, New Year gatherings, all that stuff. Everything else is in your program, everything that you need to know. And like I said, you can tear off your Connect card and you can put that in the offering boxes, which are in the little pass-through hallway there as you head out. That's also, of course, how we take our offering, how you can financially contribute to the mission and purpose of what goes on here in North Hills Christian Church, to be grateful for what God has done and is continuing to do and to give thanks in that way. That's what that is for, okay? We're glad you're here. Why don't we stand and continue worshiping this morning?
Guiding light that brought us to
him known and make him famous. Sing it out, sing a new hallelujah. Hey! Arise, let the church arise. To come together as a church family to worship you today, Lord. Help us to learn from the word that Ethan will bring us today. We thank you for all the blessings you give us. In Jesus' name, amen. And you may be seated.
Well, I'm jumping in sappy right off the bat here this morning. I suspect I've cultivated a bit of a reputation as kind of a situational analyst. One who cynically observes life around me from the sidelines just to get material for Sunday morning sermon illustrations. And the truth is, my kids often get the brunt of that, right? That's kind of how it works. For the past 3 years, they've had all of their unsavory and embarrassing snapshots of their lives highlighted for all to see. So let me just say this as clearly as I can. I love my kids more than life itself. I am proud of them and who God is shaping them to be. I crave spending time with them, and I still do stupid dad stuff just to get them to roll their eyes or make them giggle or something of the sort. I love my kids, and none of them can... Oh, I got eye contact. That's good. My kids are an extension. They're an extension of who I am. They're uniquely created to be expressly different individuals, and they're reflections of their dad. And with my human imperfections, that's not always a good thing for them. Sorry, guys. But next summer may be the time where they leave the nest for the world of college, and Debbie and I are going to miss them more than they will understand now. And I know, of course, I'm not the only parent that feels these things. Our children are cherished treasures. They're pieces of ourselves, and they're a gift from God. Like it says in Psalm 127, verse 3, children are a blessing and a gift from the Lord. But here's why I say this. So with the place our kids hold in our hearts, why, with everything we've been talking about with God's character and identity in recent weeks in this series, about being compassionate and gracious and slow to anger and abounding in love and faithfulness, why does our theme verse end by saying, He does not leave the guilty unpunished. He punishes the children and their children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation? What the heck? If God is all of those things we've spent all these weeks talking about, how can He do this? Innocent kids punished three and four generations out for the mistakes of their parents and grandparents and great-grandparents? If you have kids and you've ever made ungodly choices at any point in your life, I'll bet this is the week in the series you've been dreading like a churning pit in your stomach, right? Well, we've been in a message series called What's in a Name. We've been working to dismantle those ways that we've misunderstood or mischaracterized God, to identify those characteristics that we assign to God that interfere with us knowing Him for who He really is. And to do that, we're looking at how God describes Himself from a passage in the Old Testament that Bible writers would end up using over and over in the Scriptures. It's in Exodus chapter 34, and it's been our theme verse for the series. Let's review that. Then the Lord came down in the cloud and stood there with him and proclaimed his name, the Lord. And he passed in front of Moses, proclaiming, the Lord, compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands, and forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. He punishes the children and their children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation. We've spent some time already throughout this series establishing that God invites us to call him by a name, not just a title, the name Yahweh. And that's the name he invites us to call him on the basis of a relationship. We've also looked at why God needs a name in the first place, that reality that we live in a spiritually charged world with other forces at work, other little g gods, as we've said. But Yahweh is the one God above all gods, which was an earth-shattering claim in Old Testament times when gods were seen as many, many beings. Then we looked at that phrase, compassionate and gracious, where we saw compassionate is a feeling word, like the soul-deep treasuring a mother feels for her baby, and then gracious is the action word that means to demonstrate favor or mercy. The one describes the other. God's feeling of compassion prompts his acts of being gracious, of caring and rescuing and intervening on behalf of his children. Then we looked at the phrase slow to anger, how Yahweh is incredibly patient and self-controlled. But because of his passion for righteousness and justice, there does come a point where his anger speaks and says enough. Because like we said, sometimes anger is the appropriate response to evil and exploitation and injustice. And then last week, we parked on that phrase, abounding in love and faithfulness, to talk about God's enduring promise, his covenant of steadfast loyalty and mercy that he's been writing out since the beginning of time, ultimately reaching its triumphant expression in the person of Jesus Christ. If you've missed any of the weeks in this series, I would strongly encourage you to catch up on those online. They're all there. Because this rich description of God needs to kind of be understood altogether, especially in light of what we're talking about this morning. But so that brings us to the last section of the description. Maybe the one, like I said, that you've been dreading for weeks. The full text of verse 7, where God describes himself as maintaining love to thousands and forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin, yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. He punishes the children and their children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation. As long as I can remember, I've been a bad news first kind of person. You know, when someone asks you, what do you want first, the good news or the bad news? For me, it's always the bad news. I want to deal with the unwonderful stuff first so that I can then go on and truly enjoy the wonderful stuff. That's just kind of how I operate. It's probably why I'll eat the old leftovers in the fridge before I make things I really like. Or while I'll eat the carrots and the green beans or whatever veggie it is on my Thanksgiving plate before I dive into the 3 pounds of mashed potatoes that are sitting there. But no cauliflower, by the way. Drawing the line at cauliflower on Thanksgiving, because that grieves the heart of God. Anyway, that's me. That's me. I'm a bad news first kind of a guy. So let's start with the bad news first about today's passage. The bad news is we don't get to pick and choose with the scriptures. We just don't. As followers of Jesus, we follow our rabbi's example, Jesus, and he took scripture seriously, very seriously. And that means that we come under the authority of scripture. We choose that. We voluntarily come under his word as an expression of our submission to his lordship in our lives. And that means all of scripture. We don't get to toss out the things we don't like that much, or that push on our bruises too much, or that challenge our worldview. We don't have that option. I feel like I've said this a lot over the last year plus, but we must let our lives conform to God's word to shape us and mold our views and beliefs, not the other way around, not to try to mold and shape God's word to fit our ideologies. So that's the bad news, right? With scripture, when we read things like this, when we get to something we don't like or that's a hard pill to swallow, we deal with it. We wrestle and we study and we pray and we seek wisdom. Sometimes crying out to God, like I know I have in the past, with a prayer like, God, this stings. I don't understand this. Help me to have your eyes and your heart. Teach me. Help me, God. Help me in this. The danger with all of this is if we're not willing to do that, not willing to fully submit ourselves to the whole of Scripture and its authority, we end up risking fashioning God in our image. God becomes this imaginary being who happens to agree with us about nearly everything, who we use to reinforce everything we like and to justify the bad thoughts about everything we don't. And that God can never save us, because that's not the God of the Bible. Even with that said, I think if we let ourselves really dig in and seek to learn about this terrifying-sounding final paragraph in God's description of himself, I believe what we'll find is a God that is bigger and holier and yet somehow more amazing and wonderful than we ever imagined. That's the bad news. As we start going through this final piece here in the Exodus paragraph, I want to remind you of something really important that we've been saying all along. Remember how early on we noted in ancient Hebrew literature that when there's a list of descriptive phrases and adjectives, the first one in the list is always the most important. That's standard Hebrew literature. And it is not only that, but it is the terms by which the rest of the list is to be understood. And that opening phrase for us, remember, is compassionate and gracious God. That is the phrase that underpins everything else, meaning everything else we read in this Exodus description needs to be consistent with that, needs to be understood in terms of God's compassion and acts of mercy and rescue, okay? With that in mind, let's dive into this together. All right, the first phrase that we get to in that final paragraph is maintaining love to thousands. This is really just kind of an expansion of last week's concept. Remember that Hebrew word chesed, that sweeping covenant word for unfailing love and loyalty? Well, here it is again. But this time there's emphasis on ongoing, maintaining. A good snapshot comes in Psalm 40:11. It says, "Do not withhold your mercy from me, Lord. May your love and faithfulness always protect me." This is kind of the language that we're talking about, as God as one who watches over, who guards from those who are evil, so that his people can get to experience that unfailing love and loyalty, that chesed. That's what maintaining love to thousands is a picture of and is talking about, okay? Next up comes forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. Sometimes we think that forgiveness just shows up with Jesus, but the Old Testament is full of passages and stories and examples of Yahweh's forgiveness. And this phrase here, how he is a God forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin, these were three separate Hebrew words that very purposefully cover every possible ancient cultural understanding of bad stuff. All the ways you can think of it. All the ways humanity can miss the mark and disobey. These three words encompass the behaviors, the attitudes, the evil intent, the selfish motivations, the immoral, the unethical, the legally criminal, all of it. In those three words translated as wickedness, rebellion, and sin. There is no bad behavior or bad anything that can happen that is not represented by those three words in Hebrew. And notice something important here. Notice what's going on with these words like maintaining and forgiving. Those, again, are active, ongoing words. It's not maintained or forgave. It's not even maintains and forgives. It indicates an ongoing component of God's character that will continue to be in place. What if I was giving you a description of myself, and it went something like this? My name is Ethan, the compassionate yet sometimes selfish father, occasionally quick to anger, abounding in appetite for bread and pasta, maintaining love for hundreds of savory dishes, eating Alfredo's, manicotti, and focaccia. See, with that line, eating, you would get the picture that I'm someone who never stops eating and thinking of food. You might be right. But anyway, it wouldn't just be something I did once or even something I did a bunch of times. It has been happening, it is currently happening, and it will keep happening into the future. So much so that it's become a part of who I am, a part of my very character and identity. You see how that works? This phrase emphasizes that Yahweh is in the active, ongoing act of forgiving. It's part of his character. This isn't referring to something that he just kind of does on the side or some activity he occasionally enjoys. This is God's description of who he is. His identity, his very character is forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. Interesting, that Hebrew word translated as forgiving is a word that means lifting up, carrying, and taking away. Do you see the foreshadowing of Jesus in the cross there? The one who would lift sin onto his shoulders and then take it away as far as the east is from the west? Like John the Baptist said in John 1:29, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." But then look at this great passage. This is from the prophet Micah, found in Micah chapter 7, starting in verse 18. "Who is a God like you, who pardons sin and forgives the transgression of the remnant of his inheritance? You do not stay angry forever, but delight to show mercy. You will again have compassion on us. You will tread our sins underfoot and hurl all our iniquities into the depths of the sea." Look at the inclusion there of this idea that God delights in mercy. That's another phrase that we see a lot throughout the Old Testament. This is a love and compassion and forgiveness that wells up from the very essence of Yahweh's being. There's an Exodus scholar who's done a series of commentaries, and he writes this. He says, "He does not reluctantly forgive sins against himself and others. He does so eagerly as a manifestation of his character." When something is a part of who you naturally are, it comes very easily, right? That's what we see here, a God who is longing to restore and rescue and set free, longing to forgive, who delights to show mercy, forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin, because that's who he is. Okay, we've got all that is out of the way, and that still more or less sounds like much of what we've read so far in God's description from the beginning of the series, right? It's time to move on to the section that many of you have been dreading from the beginning, the part that puts the lump in your throat, that pivot in the language in God's description of himself, where the next phrase starts, "Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished." Stay with me through the end of this because this gets good. All right, quick show of hands here in a minute. Don't overthink this question, please. Just raise your hand if you like to see the guilty punished. Raise your hand. Come on, hands up if that's you. If I was sitting out there, my hand would absolutely be up. The guy that cuts you off in traffic, the neighbor who never cleans up their dog's messes on your lawn, the cafeteria bully who used to pin you up against the wall and take your lunch money. So that's what we're putting the hands up for, right? If you give a big thumbs up for the guilty being punished. Now I'm going to give you permission to overthink it. Do you really? All the guilty to get the punishment they deserve? Or do you just mean people that aren't named you or that aren't people you care about, those guilty people? Are you willing to carry this out the whole way through with consistency? For you, all of the reacting in anger, all of the little grudges, all of the times of gossip that you called concern, all the fear and the worry, all the indiscreet places your eyes looked and your internet browser searched, all the layers of small deceptions over the years, all the careless and condescending words, all the empty promises, all the subtle ways of manipulating to get the results you want, all the time of putting others down to make yourself feel better, all the times you said you'd pray for someone and you didn't, times of getting test answers from a friend at school or coasting through stop signs or speeding on I-279, and all the pens you've taken from the church. We count those every week, you know. Should we do another show of hands? So this phrase, yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. I want you to see something pretty important here. It's that first word, yet. Remember how we said early on that first descriptive phrase in Hebrew is always the most important? It's the lens through which we see all the other descriptors. Compassionate and gracious is that phrase for us. Nothing that is in the adjectives that follow is ever going to contradict that description, but instead to serve and support it. So when we read in verse 7, where God describes himself as maintaining love to thousands and forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin, yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished, and so forth. Maintaining love, forgiving, compassionate, and gracious, yet does not leave the guilty unpunished and all the rest. It's almost like God saying, yes, I'm compassionate and slow to anger, and I delight in mercy and forgiveness and all those things. But just so you don't get the idea that I'm turning a blind eye to evil and injustice and pain in this world, don't worry. Yes, I forgive and maintain love to thousands, yet I won't leave the guilty unpunished. That's kind of the language play going on here in Hebrew. You see, in many other English translations, this phrase is translated something more like, forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin, yet who will by no means clear the guilty. This is the assurance that God is not going to leave evil unaddressed. Yahweh is assuring us that even though he's abounding in love and compassion and mercy and faithfulness and all of that, that those things don't negate his justice and his anger at evil. He loves and forgives, but he is no less passionate about justice and righteousness. We see this borne out time and again throughout the Old Testament scriptures. When we repent, he responds with mercy, compassion, faithfulness, and grace. But if we don't, he'll only wait so long before he puts a stop to the destruction and the pain of our rampage, right? One way or another. That's his justice and righteousness. And we want that, right? We've said that. We want to know that there is hope for a world where there are no more Hitlers, no more suicide bombers, no more wives thrown downstairs by rage-filled husbands, no more child predators or lying and cheating governments, no more corporate greed driving public policy, no more racism in our systems or carcinogens in our drinking water, no more 6,000% big pharma price increases for necessary medications. No more church sex scandals. God, please tell me your abounding love isn't just going to give all of that stuff a free pass. And to that comes, yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished line. where God says, yes, my character is compassionate and gracious and forgiving, and I delight in mercy. But yet, even with that, don't worry. I haven't lost my commitment to justice and goodness, because I am in the business of making everything right and new and good once and for all. You follow this? Okay, here we go with the very last one. The one that everyone with kids has been trembling over, fearing that your kids and grandkids are going to feel the wrath of hell because of that one time in college you didn't leave your server a good tip. Shame on you, by the way. Anyway, I've already had a few of you try to corner me and ask me about this verse, asking me, what's the end game? How is all this going to turn out? Are my great-grandkids going to suffer God's wrath because of my bad choices? For that matter, am I going to suffer God's wrath because of my great-grandparents' bad choices? I've tried to be evasive with all your answers because I didn't want to spoil the world premiere of this morning's message. Anyway, here's the final line in God's description of himself that seems so difficult for us. He punishes the children and their children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation. We read this and we think, could this really be face value here? God really punishes kids for their parents' sin? In several other English translations, that phrase is translated, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children. That sounds a little different. And in yet others, brings the consequences of the sin of the fathers to the children. Clearly, there's more here than just the face value of our one English translation. I need to say this. It's always important to read any scripture consistent with the whole of scripture, to seek to understand scripture in tune with itself. You see, there's several other passages somewhere where Moses is again talking with the people of Israel. We read verses like this in Deuteronomy 26. Parents are not to be put to death for their children, nor children put to death for their parents. Each will die for his own sin, for their own sin. Or here's another one. The prophet Jeremiah was quoting from Exodus 34 when he wrote this in Jeremiah 32. You show love to thousands, but bring the punishment for the parents' sins into the laps of their children after them. Great and mighty God, whose name is the Lord Almighty, great are your purposes and mighty are your deeds. Your eyes are open to the ways of all mankind. You reward each person according to their conduct and as their deeds deserve. The punishment of the parents' sin falls into the laps of their children. And then again, like the Deuteronomy passage, saying God rewards each person according to their conduct. So what's up with this phrase? How do we hash all of this out with the whole of Scripture? Does it really mean if grandma cheats on her taxes, God's going to take it out on little Johnny? Is that what we're talking about? I think we can all understand the unfortunate reality that sin of parents has consequences for their children, right? If mom and dad run a meth lab in the trunk of their car and get nabbed by the police and thrown in jail, it's the kids that'll suffer the most, right? Maybe a childhood spent in foster homes and dumped on the streets when they hit 18. Those kids are going to fight an uphill battle with all sorts of setbacks as a result of their parents' sin. But we can get a little less extreme sounding. Think about divorce. Our culture's ridiculous PR machine tries to sell divorce as this friendly transition of self-care and finding happiness, where everyone comes out just fine. But we all know that's a sham, because the statistics tell a very different story. When mom and dad get a divorce, the children are the collateral. That doesn't mean it's hopeless, by no means. It just means the children get the fallout. They will process and cope with varying degrees of emotional and relational handicaps as a result of mom and dad's choice. It doesn't take a stretch for us to see how the sin of parents absolutely falls in the laps, as Jeremiah calls it, of the generations that come after. We can even go further than that. I call this the all-in-the-family principle. Good old Archie Bunker. You remember Archie Bunker? If you grew up with Archie Bunker as your dad, odds are pretty good that you're going to inherit some bad habits and some unhealthy perspectives that demean and dehumanize others based on ethnicity or skin color or gender or vocation or whatever Archie felt like mouthing off about that day, right? And then others of you that have no idea who Archie Bunker is, you're like, what are you talking about? Children grow up to reflect what they've seen and heard at home, what has been modeled for them. Some of that can be genetics that can have a leaning towards a fiery temper or towards addiction and dependency, or it can just be the sinful day-to-day habits that are modeled and practiced and become a way of life for the children. No matter how you slice it, we all grow up with all sorts of baggage from our family line, right? We all experience degrees of sin consequences that make their way down through the generations. There's a great biblical example of this in the book of Numbers. Moses has been leading the Israelites toward the eventual promised land. Just like we've seen in past weeks, though, God's people, like us, have this nagging habit of being unfaithful despite God's faithfulness. And it's generations of that back and forth. Maybe you remember the Nehemiah recounting that we did last week. But anyway, they finally reach the edge of the promised land. God says, I'm with you. It's time. It's yours for the taking. Except it turns out that land is inhabited by these fearsome warriors and the people aren't having it. If you look at how Numbers 14 opens, it says, all the Israelites grumbled against Moses and Aaron, and the whole assembly said to them, if only we had died in Egypt or in this wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us to this land only to let us fall by the sword? Our wives and children will be taken as plunder. Wouldn't it be better for us to go back to Egypt? And they said to each other, we should choose a leader and go back to Egypt. Now, we know that the story that comes after, we know where we stand now, and so we look at this and say, those poor Israelites, boy, they were so thick-headed. No, this is so utterly human. This is us. Because so often, at its root, sin is about trust. Do we really, really trust that God is who he says, that he will do what he promised? Sin is when we refuse to embrace that, and we just trust our judgment instead of God's. That's what's happening here in Numbers. Moses and his leaders, they plead with the people, telling them, this is an exceedingly good land, and Yahweh will go with us. He has promised us. Don't rebel. Don't spit in his face like you have before. You can almost hear Moses saying, we're finally here, everybody. Please don't be unfaithful again. But here's what happens next. But the whole assembly talked about stoning them. Some pastors say this is exactly what happens when you try and lead people into uncomfortable places and new challenges in their faith. Then the glory of the Lord appeared at the tent of meeting to all the Israelites. The Lord said to Moses, how long will these people treat me with contempt? How long will they refuse to believe in me in spite of all the signs I have performed among them? There's more back and forth between Moses and the people, more back and forth between Moses and God, where Moses ultimately pleads and God agrees to forgive the people. But look at the judgment that comes down. Nevertheless, as surely as I live and as surely as the glory of the Lord fills the whole earth, not one of them will ever see the land I promised on oath to their ancestors. Goes on to say, as for you, your bodies will fall in this wilderness. Your children will be shepherds here for 40 years, suffering for your unfaithfulness. Do you see the clarity this story brings out? Because this is exactly Yahweh being who he said he was in Exodus 34. The people were forgiven because God is a God who forgives. But there were consequences of their sin, consequences to them and their children. Children who would now wander for 40 more years with their parents, relegated to living as nomadic shepherds at the edge of the promised land to watch their parents die out there in the wilderness before they would finally be able to step into the promised land themselves. So here is this critical phrase I think we can land on this morning. Yahweh is forgiving. But sin is not. Yahweh is forgiving, but sin is not. Maybe your parents love Jesus and have been forgiven for their sin. But number one, that doesn't cancel out the consequences and the generational fallout of that sin, number one. And number two, that doesn't get you off the hook for your sin. Do you see how things draw together with consistency when we look at the whole of Scripture? Yahweh is forgiving, but sin is not. You see, it's because Yahweh is a merciful and compassionate and forgiving God who wants to see the destructive cycle of sin and evil and pain come to an end. It's because of that that God's love and faithfulness will continue to chase away sin and evil generation by generation until it's eventually, fully, and finally gone. God won't stop until you're completely free. Are you starting to see this? This is where Jesus comes in. The whole Old Testament is this state of God's compassion and mercy, kind of in tension with his justice and his fight against evil. And so that Old Testament pattern of animal sacrifice that we see, where people sin and a lamb then dies in their place, that just serves as a temporary stopgap so that God's anger and mercy can continue to fight on behalf of his children. But it was just that, it was temporary. Remember last week, that vision that Abraham had, where Yahweh walked through the animal sacrifices to make the covenant by himself, where he vowed on his own blood that he would make good on his promise no matter the cost? Enter Jesus, the Lamb of God. We read that verse earlier. Yahweh would provide himself to finally be that bridge between his mercy and his judgment, because he won't stop until you're completely free. That's Jesus. That is what we remember and celebrate every week when we take communion. That God's justice met his unfailing love on the cross when Jesus became the sacrifice for our sin. That word sin, I'm actually going to challenge us with another thought about that before we close. But for now, we're going to take communion this morning. This time of ceremony where we take bread and juice to remind us of the body and blood of Jesus given up for us. That perfect sacrifice initiated by Yahweh himself that we might be forgiven and free. So if you put your trust in Jesus, we invite you to take communion with us this morning, whether with the packets you got when you were coming in or the extras that are in the pew or some elements that you have at home if you're joining us online. If you're unsure about all of this, just use this time for quiet reflection, okay? Let's pray and then we're going to take communion together. Father God, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands and yet not leaving the guilty unpunished. God, that tension between your incredible compassion and mercy and love and yet your justice, your holiness, your righteousness, that tension, God, you took that upon yourself when you sent Jesus to be that sacrifice for us and our sin, our wickedness and evil. God, we claim that this morning. We celebrate and remember that with both somber hearts and grateful hearts and celebratory hearts because you conquered sin and death once and for all. God, we remember that this morning and we thank you for your love and your faithfulness and your forgiveness. We pray this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's take communion.
Is built on nothing less. just the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy shall come with trumpets out. Oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne.
Phrase we just sang, Christ alone. That's Yahweh walking through that covenant sacrifice by Himself. That's God taking the weight of our sin on Himself, because that was the only way that His love and compassion and mercy could reconcile with His anger against evil and injustice. Through Christ and Christ alone, Yahweh made the way Himself. But there's one other thing we need to hear this morning before we close out. It's the very, very real other part of our Exodus text about sin's punishment and consequence. I said earlier that Yahweh is forgiving, but sin is not. Followers of Jesus, I believe we need to take sin a lot more seriously than we do. And I want to challenge you with that this morning. Because your Father's mercy and love knows no bounds, but that doesn't mean He takes your sin less seriously. In fact, it likely means He takes it even more seriously because you're His child. He sees all you can be and will keep chasing after those things that are holding you back and tripping you up and causing destruction. Just like the Hebrews passage says, the Lord disciplines those He loves. So in just a minute, we're going to close in prayer. And if you're a follower of Jesus, I'm going to urge you to repent. Repent of your sin, of those patterns and habits and episodes you've been brushing off, you've been casually living with and not doing anything about, because you know you're a loved child of God and He's a forgiving God after all. I think it's time we take our sin seriously. So I'm going to encourage you to do that, to urge you to do that, to repent, to come to a place of genuine sorrow over your sin, to name it and release it to Jesus, the one who shoulders it all on that cross and then broke its chain when he rose from the grave 3 days later, sending it as far away as the east is from the west. But maybe you're here this morning and you've never done that before. Never made Jesus your Lord. Never accepted that gift of salvation and forgiveness. Never stepped into new life through baptism. The good news is you can bring all the pain and the mess ups and the brokenness of your life to Jesus here and now. You can give that to him and in turn receive mercy and be forgiven. That's what he does because that's who he is. I'm going to be up here after we close if you're ready to make any kind of decision this morning. Some of our elders will also be up here for prayer or questions you may have. But for now, I want to close in prayer. I'm going to lead us, and then I'm going to leave a little bit of blank space where I urge you to take time to lay your sin at the foot of the cross, to take it seriously, to repent, because Yahweh never stops chasing down the evil and the sin and injustice that wreaks havoc on his children and their children and their children. He won't stop until you're completely free. Let's pray together. Gracious, compassionate God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands, yet not leaving guilt unpunished. Father, we are so deeply grateful for your mercy, your steadfast love that never stops pursuing us, never stops chasing after the sin that destroys your children. God, there are so many of us here in our midst carrying baggage and remnants of sin from past years and generations. God, sin is cruel, sin is lethal, sin is so destructive, so unforgiving, but you are a God forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. So, Father, this morning we claim the blood of your Son and we repent. We lay at the foot of the cross our sin, our shame, our pain, our secrets and deceptions. And God, we confess to you all the ways we have shrugged off sin, treating it casually and indifferently, while you paid the price of your Son so that we could be free. God, here and now, we repent. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. Father, we praise and thank you for that love and forgiveness, and for not stopping until we are free. We pray in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Can we stand and close in a song of freedom together this morning?
Green. All right, green means on. Good. Just want to take a minute here. You know, we are blessed 365 days a year by the staff we have here. And Jeff, come on, sneak up here too, please. I know Katie's not here. But, you know, every year, every day, they're serving here. And, you know, Christmas is a nice time for us to recognize all the people that are playing significant parts in our lives and you know, spurring us on to service for the Lord. Just come by on a weekday sometime, and you'll see how many lives and how many people were impacted by the work these people are doing here. And it's fantastic. So before I give them this gift, how about a nice round of applause? So, we appreciate you, we love you. We really do. So I have this for Jeff, and Ethan, I'll give you Katie's too. And,
Absolutely.
Well, I think so. And I'll do everybody a favor and turn this off before we sing.
Sunday, Friday, 5 p.m. Christmas Eve service. We're dismissed.